gathered the best light you could and took a picture of the Earth, it would be a picture of, you use light that arrived in the ground today, it would be light that came from the Earth 2 million years ago. They, even though there's 7,000 years of history here, there would be no evidence of any life on Malta, no human life at all. Human beings, we didn't come into existence. So there would be no evidence of any existence of humanity or intelligent life anywhere on the Earth, even though we think there's some now. And so it gives you one of the problems that we have with the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. There's a time and space problem that makes it more difficult. But that's the nearest big galaxy. So this galaxy down here, we're looking out the greater great spheres. When we look out and see M31, we're looking at one of the nearest big galaxies. And a typical galaxy is between 100 million light years away and billions of light years away. So when you get a picture of them, you're getting pictures of the galaxy the way it was 100 million years ago or a billion years ago, or up to 6-7 billion years ago in those pictures. So it's when you're making pictures of sections of spheres out in different distances, you're making not only a map of the universe in different distances, but you're making a map of the universe in different epochs. So that you, if you just take a sequence of pictures, you will see the development of the average. So the example of what we kind of do in science, I was involved in a project that the Department of Plants and Forestry did, which was took a section of land in California and cut the trees, and they planted a forest for those kind of panels. Next year they came and planted another section of forest, and next year they came. So they had a forest that was 1 year old, 2 years old, 3 years old. And they've been doing that for 30 years. So there's a sequence of trees in all the different ages, so you can see. We're doing the same thing here. We're making observations and seeing what the universe, samples of the universe look like at different epochs along the way. And then you can keep going further back until you go to this pink and blue area. Because the universe is expanding, we're also seeing a change in the temperature of the universe. But that's back to the point where the temperature of the universe is about the same as the temperature of the sun is right now. And that's as far back as you can look. But that's back almost to the very beginning. So a very funny thing in this map is we're looking back until we reach what we call the cosmic photosphere, instead of looking at the surface of the sun. We look back, we can see back that far, we still see objects and so forth there. And to see further, we have to use more tricks. But the very beginning is just on the other side of that. It's a very thin slice on the other side. So we are not completely without hope. We can actually take slices of the universe, sections of spheres of the universe, back at different distances, therefore back at different times, and we can map the history of the universe. That we can compare to our theories and our ideas on how the universe developed, and we can see what the history of the universe was and try and understand what's going on. So here's my recap. We live in a spiral galaxy. We live in the arm of the spiral galaxy about here. There are spheres around us we're going to look at. So our galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy, is a nice, beautiful spiral galaxy. And that's one of the things we suspected that for a long time, but we have strong evidence that actually it's a barred spiral. There's a bar in the center of our galaxy, just like there's a bar in the center of town. It's a different kind of bar. It's sort of a rock, a original thing. Just that we only learned about the little bar right up there. But we live out there in the spiral arm, and we can look out of the galaxy perpendicular to the spiral arm very well. Looking on the plane of the galaxy, it's more difficult. We have to avoid that very often. But there are some things we go through. Around us, we see another modern, what we call modern light galaxy, these beautiful kind of spiral galaxies, elliptical galaxies. Everywhere is so modern. Further out, we see galaxies that are younger and forming. And you see there are certain odd shapes and angry purple and blues. And we share when we tell you more about them. But that's a place where we know there's a lot more starburst activity that's going on. So we'll see. Okay. So here's the picture with all the details. The beginning of time on the outside, the universe is very hot. Getting to this point, there's roughly the center of the sun. And then what we call the dark ages, which starts to form. And the first stars and galaxies turning on. And the thing is wrong with this picture is these drawings are nice, but it should have 100 billion galaxies in it instead of the space. That's a little bit hard to show. So we're on in progress about making these plots. So here's an example of low-map version. So extended, this is one of these things. So there's a sphere at the center, which is the Earth. We're actually doing observations from on the Earth. The satellite is relatively near the Earth, within a couple million kilometers of the Earth. And then around the Milky Way seems to wrap. And that's just where we're measuring this is from the Earth. Most of the Milky Way is on one side, which is not at the edge of it. And then there are nearby galaxies and further away galaxies. And then finally, this surface where the temperature of the universe is close to the time near the temperature of the sun. And this we call the cosmic microwave background, which is relatively interesting thing. So it's expanding the universe is just this wavelength from invisible down into the microwave region. And so we have this sequence of spheres around us, and I'll show you some pictures later on. So studying this is what I spent a lot of my career doing. And we had a series of satellites. So in November 1989, so almost exactly 25 years ago, we launched the Cosmic Background Program. This celebration is coming up in November. Nearly 25 years ago, we launched the Cosmic Background Explorer satellite. We measured the spectrum. We saw it was really the radiation coming from the Big Bang that had all the properties of the Big Bang. And then we measured the maps very precisely and found these small variations, which is really important for those sort of patterns. Then in 2000, Levy map, I'm sure you guys have to tell me what was launched. And he made a series of maps, taking data every couple of years, releasing the map, and making relatively high resolution maps where we have to connect with the galaxy and use all the wavelengths. And that basically has to smooth things a little bit, but providing more detail. And then finally, in 2009, we launched the Planck satellite, which just finished taking data last year, had a big release of data. Well, one release of data has already happened. Another big release will be happening in November. We will see results. And it has even better angular resolution, better sensitivity. And these benchmarks means we're also trying to measure the polarization of the temperature background much more precisely. Because just like when light scatters off the water or off a glass, it's partly polarized, any anisotropic light in the beginning of the universe will be partly polarized. So I have a little movie if things work. So this is the Planck satellite, the third generation satellite. It faces, it's about 1.5 million kilometers away from the Earth with the sun and the Earth behind it. And so it has solar cells and the radio transmitter on that side. And the cool instruments on this side. There is a big dish antenna in the secondary area, some receivers. And these scan around and take data from the sky and build up an image of the sky. You'll see the plane of our own galaxy showing up here in the dust. It's combined all different wavelengths. So the dust shows up in white, the universe shows up in this red color. And you have to pick the right frequencies in order to see the universe. But the extra frequencies and wavelengths allow us to separate out what's a single point from the galaxy and what's a difference from the universe as a whole. How we can separate the various spheres. So here is the plane of our galaxy. You see how thin it is compared to how wide it is. This is the same optical picture. There's the dust again. This is our unvarnished view of the universe. Here we have to be careful because the dust is not good. But we can subtract that away and blow the scale up tremendously. It turns out the universe is extraordinarily uniform across the sky, uniform to about a part 10 to the fifth. And you take the various account. But on top of that, at a part 100,000, there are variations, and those variations show very, very unusual and interesting patterns. There are regions where there are warm spots together, cold spots together, warm spots together, cold spots together, warm spots together. This complicated pattern, there's some long wavelength structures and many short wavelength structures, and then there's within the scale that's picked out, which is set by the sine horizon of the universe. You make a little tap on the universe, sound waves spread out, and there's a certain distance they can get to before the universe gets to the temperature of the sun, and then you get a snapshot of those, that's the size that shows up. So this is just showing that with my satellite observing that sky, even though the sky wraps around. So we have been making higher and higher resolution maps. Sorry for the Spanish. I don't know what he's saying. Sometimes it's Spanish, sometimes it's French, sometimes it's Italian. So Kobe, the same Eastern sky, Kobe gave us a very large scale view of what's going on. That map gave us more resolution, and it's giving us much more details about what's going on, and much more precision, so we're no longer worried about the first order things. We not only look at what we think the beginning of the universe looks like, and it's fine detail, but we look to see what might, small things might have looked like on its path from the beginning of the universe through all materials in the universe to get to us. And from that, we've made up this map. So if you remember, there's a sphere around us, and you see around the spheres going back and forth, you take a slice, you can look at that what it looks like. What happens is this is the present universe of some modern galaxies. So we have this period for the last 4 to 5 billion years of accelerated rate of expansion. The universe is expanding, but to our surprise, about 12 years ago, we started realizing the universe is starting to accelerate again, and we'll be able to hear about that. But this later part, the, instead of slowing down and slowing down, the universe is starting to expand more and more rapidly. So that was a surprise, and that's happening in the last sort of third of the history of the universe, what's going on. But as you go back in time, you go back to the earlier galaxies, and the first stars were going to happen about 400 million years ago. But during this phase, from year around to year, the universe was slowing down. That is, the universe is expanding at a slower and slower rate. And that's a critical time for the universe when we do our calculations. The only way we can form galaxies, clusters of galaxies, and large structures such as that, is if the universe is not expanding too rapidly and the matter has time to aggregate. If the universe expands faster and faster, we would not get the structures. So, it turns out the dark matter plays a critical role, but the fact that the universe is not expanding faster and faster plays a critical role. If the universe had been accelerating from the beginning, the universe would look very different. And about, when the universe was about 400 million years ago, we think the first generation of stars turning on, and those turn out to be critical because they're going to end up making the heavier elements. The light elements are made in very early times in the Big Bang, but the heavier elements are made in the stars, and the first generation stars are critical for making a lot of the elements and a lot of the things that are necessary to eventually create planets. You know, if you just use the primordial material from the beginning of the universe, you don't have the rocky cores, you don't have things like the iron, the silicon, the iron things that make the cores of the Earth and make the cores of the gas giants. You can only get some gas giants. You can't make the kind of planetary systems that we have today without those first generation stars starting to make the heavier elements in the universe. And we will even see in the stuff that we can hear about from that order, we think one of the theories we have today of where the very heavy elements come from is the merging of neutron stars. When the neutron stars merge, often they will make a black hole, but they will throw out some neutron star material, which is extremely neutron rich and can drive us beyond iron out to the transuranic element and produce things like gold. So for some reason, people here have treasured for thousands of years. And so we have this complicated process where we make light elements at the beginning, middle elements up through iron, and the stars, and supernova and solar winds. And then perhaps at the end, it's the dying stars, double death, that causes the very even heavier elements. And we had to have all of those in order to make the kind of structure that we had on Earth. So we have this picture, and every step along the way, there are steps we understand, and they're all individually simple. But when you add all these concepts together, it gets to be a complicated, it gets to be like the Aeneas. It's a small, complicated tale made of many simple little episodes of that. Okay, so in addition to making the maps of the universe, we're also making maps of galaxies. So I want to show you pictures of a couple of the surveys. So here's a picture that has a million galaxies in it. every galaxy.
Do I need to hear that?
That's right.
We're a little late, but you have a chance. Since I'm giving the popular talk, a different version of the popular talk, you'll have another chance to get it tonight. So I'll have a different version, slightly different version tonight, but a lot of the same slides. Okay, so just like we had the picture from Hubble, you can take pictures from on the ground. You take your telescope and you take a picture. You get a cone, a picture that gives you a cone of galaxies looking out from there. And you can say, all right, there's a star, I can recognize the stars and throw the stars away. And every galaxy, I have its angle, and I estimate its distance, and I can make a plot. And I put a little green point here for every plot. And as the Earth rotates, I take a series of pictures. So I will get this cone will turn into a fan across the sky. And then I can turn the telescope to a different angle and do the same thing again. And I'll put those dots in pink. So if you look in the background, there's a pink one too. And then there are places I can't see very well because the galaxy, the dust on the galaxy obscures it. So I'll show you a little movie, a little low resolution movie that shows the geometry of the early, the Sloan 1-2 sky surveys, and then I'll show you a movie at the end of the survey. So in here you'll see this object, so it's sort of distorted. All right. This was supposed to loop, but it decided not to loop. Can't seem to get it to, well, let's do it the hard way. So you can see the galaxies are not spread uniformly. They're not, they're voids. They're places where there are many galaxies together in a cluster. And there's this one region which we call the Great Wall, this section right along here. I don't understand why it didn't loop, but we'll have to see. Can't get it to loop. All right. But you see the geometry. It's not that there are not galaxies here or even further out. These are too faint to see. Here are places we didn't look. But where we have looked, we see this complicated structures of galaxies. And so we not only have to explain why there are so many galaxies, we have to explain why the galaxies decide to be in small groups, in large clusters, and in superclusters. And if you even look, there are places where there are clusters and clusters of galaxies together. And I'll show you better in a movie I'll break out to later on. I would put it in the talk here, but it's too big to fit in the talk easily. So you see this kind of structure. So this is not the only science survey that was going on. There was another survey called the 2-degree field of view survey, which is now a 6-degree field of view survey. We're going to fly through the galaxies. So you'll realize not only do we know where the galaxies are, but we have little postage stamp pictures of every galaxy. We know its color, we know its shape, we know this kind of material. And you can see galaxies are sometimes in groups, sometimes in voids, right? There's almost no galaxies or no galaxies in certain regions. Now we're swinging outside, you'll look back and see, but doing the observations on the Earth and with limited telescope time, you're forced into a certain geometry, a sort of two-dimensional kind of geometry here. You get these wedge shapes on the sky. And you can see these structures, places where there are voids, places where there are clusters, and groups of clusters that kind of string together. And this is another section of that thing we call the Great Wall. These two don't be in the same place, but you see the Great Wall, which we saw on another wedge further out, extends. So it's not just a line of galaxies. It's a whole wall of galaxies. So one of our problems is to see how unusual is something like the Great Wall of galaxies. There is another survey which just finished. And this is called BOSS, or Sloan Digital Sky Survey 3. It finished about 3 months ago, and I have a partial movie for that. And it's gone out and tried to measure more galaxies, another factor of 5 more galaxies than the million that were done before. So it's almost 5 million galaxies. So the old survey is underneath here in yellow and red. And you see all the nearby galaxies are here. There doesn't seem to be many galaxies here. That's because the telescope time was not spent on looking at the nearby galaxies. It was specifically designed to try and study dark matter, try to see a sphere out at distances, and then there's a large section out through here. So, you know, it's like looking for your keys under the lamppost. There's a certain set of science you want to do, which is to understand why the universe is accelerating. So you pick certain spheres where the phenomena should be changing in order to try and understand what's going on. So that's what we're doing. So why does it sort of look like this? And it's, you know, it's because of the focus, but it's also because of how you pick things out. So nearby, you get almost all the galaxies, but there are just not that many galaxies because there's not much volume. Then there was an attempt to get things in a sphere here. You had to guess roughly what it is. It's only when you measure or spend the time to get the spectrum very carefully do you get to measure where it really is. But you'll see there's a sphere out here, which is on the scale of more than 1,000 megaparsecs, which is 3,000 million light years, so quite a distance out. And then there's this funny section, which is made of blue dots and red lines. Okay. And so this is the thing which takes advantage of the fact that there's an earlier generation of galaxies that turn on, and the centers of them are quasi-solar objects. They're very bright and very intense, and they shine through materials, and this is what's called the Lyman Alpha Forest. These are big clouds of primordial material, mostly hydrogen and helium, and you see the absorption in the hydrogen line of those clouds against that bright source. And so you can begin to see it. So this is what it looks like. Here's what a nearby galaxy looks like. It's got this long emission, big emission feature, and then absorption lines from the intervening gas clouds. And this is something that's relatively close by, 3C273. It's relatively close by, so a redshift of a tenth. If you go out to when the universe was 4.6 times smaller, right, the redshift of 3.62, or 1 plus that is the scale size of the universe, you see the many lines, all these hydrogen clouds that are eventually collapsing to form galaxies. You see this, and this is called a Lyman Alpha Forest because there's so many lines, right? There's all these absorption lines from these clouds that are starting to collapse to form what's going on. And so you can study. These are the things that make the red lines that we show. So the concept is there's a quasi-stellar object, and we think it's probably powered by a black hole in the center with relatively jets, as you'll hear about later on. The light starts out very blue. It gets absorbed by the first cloud, shows up here on this cover, unfortunately red, but the next one, because it will get redshifted further out, and then it gets absorbed by this cloud. It shows a notch here. It gets absorbed by this cloud, and so forth. The last cloud, it still doesn't get redshifted very much, so it's from the blue. So you see the whole sequence like this. At the beginning one, you see about this many, the 3Z273, you see about this many. But for this one, you see very, very many lines. And so you can that's how you can do the survey and get the faraway sphere, the middle sphere, and the nearby, you know, sort of complete inner sphere around us, although limited sample. And so we've been working on a project we call Big Boss, which is now called MS DAISY. DAISY stands for Dark Energy Spectroscopic Instrument, which is the instrument that'll be on the big telescope. And the idea is to go up along Moore's Law, right? So you went from 1 million galaxies to 5 million galaxies, and now you need to go to 20 or 50 million galaxies in order to keep doing it, because it's 100 billion galaxies. If you don't go up by a factor of two every few years, you're never going to get to the 100 million, right? And if the universe keeps accelerating, some of those galaxies will go out of view, so you have to do it while you have a chance, right? And so the survey there has got to essentially do every quasar in the sky and to do many more galaxies in the region, like roughly 20 million of the emission line galaxies and the large red luminous galaxies out of this region to try and fill things in more and more. And why do we do that? Well, first we want to know what's out there and how it goes, but we also want to compare it to our models. So here's a simple model where you took dark matter and you took the slight variations in the cosmic microwave background and you let gravity work for the 13 billion years. Okay, and so what you'll see is at the beginning of the universe is very uniform. Then the little peaks of distortion will end up making little peaks of structure, and then the structures will form together in a web. So first the points appear, and then the points leak up into this sort of cosmic web of dark matter. So this is a simulation that's only for dark matter, but you see how these structures form together. So this is sort of the heading towards the present day. And so you see, well, the places where you think there'll be clusters of galaxies, but you see how the clusters are kind of coordinated together too, and the voids are in the places where the clusters are formed. And it happens very quickly. First, a few isolated places appear, and then they link together into this more complicated structure. Then the universe starts accelerating, and it kind of freezes things. Larger things don't get to form anymore because the expansion of the universe prevents even larger scale structures from forming. So this is just dark matter. The dark matter is shown in white. Now I'll show you a large simulation, which was done. This is the some result that comes to the present day. On the very large scale, this is 3 billion light years. This is the scale. It's going to look very uniform. As we zoom in, you'll find more and more complicated structure. And of course, the people who did the simulation, which is the Max Planck Institute, they zoom in on the largest feature. This is a place that has hundreds of thousands of millions of galaxies in it. But we'll zoom in from what looks like a very uniform universe, and we'll see the kind of structure. So here's the start. See, it looks uniform like the carpet, but as you zoom in, you find the structure. You find the void, you find the filaments. The dark matter is in white, and the ordinary matter is in yellow like the sun. And you see why you have the voids, and you see why you have these filaments. Where filaments come together, you get a cluster of galaxies. Where very many filaments come together, you get a supercluster of galaxies, or a cluster of galaxies. So you see these guys are slowly going to be coming together over time. And we don't live in a place like, we live way out here in a place with a very small number of galaxies. So we live in a galaxy village. And you know, if we lived here, no matter which direction we looked in the sky, we would see a galaxy. Here, you have to go very carefully out on a dark night and try with the edge of your eye to see Andromeda. But the distance between us and Andromeda is about the distance between these two objects. So if we lived where most people live in the big city, we would see galaxies in every direction in the sky. It would be different than what we kind of see. Okay, now I'm going to, so this is credit to the Max Planck and Volker Spinger, who spearheaded this, for making that video. Here's a fly-through. So you will see something else here. White is the dark matter, and yellow is the ordinary matter. Ordinary matter interacts with light. It can dissipate energy. The dark matter can dissipate a certain amount of energy, but it ends up not being able to dissipate enough energy. It stays in puffs. But the ordinary matter falls into the potential wells of the dark matter, but it can lose energy and it can fall into the center of the potential well. Just like dirt, when you take a shower, falls to the bottom of the tub, the dirt falls into the center of the cluster. And so you will see there's a dark matter halo around the cluster, around the galaxy, and the ordinary matter is on the inside. So. And you can see that in the simulations if you look carefully. But it's very different when you have a map than when you're flying through. So there's a reason we make maps, just so we can comprehend what the whole thing looks like. But it's also interesting to see how a structure like this looks in 3D, where you can see the filaments all coming together in a complicated pattern. And then one of the questions whenever you do a simulation or whenever you look at the real world is, how likely is it that many filaments came together at this time to make this unusual object, right? You know, compared to what are typical kind of objects. But again, you see there's always sort of a white halo around the yellow material. Okay, so we're able to take these early measurements of the universe, places where it's a little cool, a bunch of cooler places together, or a bunch of places, warmer places. We can take a section, start with those initial conditions, expand that under gravity, just doing large numerical simulations and let the self-gravitation take into account. And you end up with these complicated sort of cell-like structures with filaments going everywhere and sheets going everywhere, and these intersections making clusters. So you start with something which is incredibly uniform. This is about as uniform as my glass of water in terms of the density variations. But over the 14 billion years, you get to this very, very complicated sort of structure. Okay, so here's a wedge history of the universe. We're the here now. We look out its spheres around us. At very early times, the universe is very hot and extremely uniform. And over time, it expands and cools, makes the elements and so forth. And then eventually, the first stars and structures start to form. But they're very irregular and they're spotty. And then they get more and more linked up until when you get to the present day, they have this sharp, you know, non-linear kinds of structures. So along this scale is how far back you look in time, 1 billion years, 2 billion years, all the way back to almost 14 billion years, you can see what's going on. Or in the redshift, that is, how much smaller the universe was or how much the wavelength has been stretched since that time. Now, here's a picture without the writing on top of it, so you can see how complicated and sharp the structure is here and how uniform and smooth the structure is when you go back. And so this is part of our idea. The universe is evolving. And what I've done in most of these pictures is take out the expansion. We use coordinate systems which stay constant even though it's expanding. So we take a frame, a cube like this, and even though that cube expands 1,000 times, on the screen we show it on a fixed scale just so you can see the features of what's going on. But here you're seeing that same kind of thing. You're looking out at angles and that's staying fixed, but the actual physical size is changing quite a lot. So we've been going through this period of grand discovery since about a little over 20 years ago when the COBE DMR looked up at the sky, taking away the galaxy, saw a smooth structure that looks like this. It has the big features. For some reason the color is not coming through. Right? The reds are kind of missing and the blues are a little faint. But if it had flipped over and looked at the Earth, it would have seen this picture. It would have missed Malta and Italy, for that matter. But it sees the big scale. It would have gotten all the continents, but it wouldn't have gotten all the islands. But this is the sort of original discovery. Then with WMAP and Planck, we have the maps look like this. This is actually the last WMAP picture that I haven't updated for the point map. If it looked at the Earth, it would look like that. And there is an interesting thing here. Notice the difference in how the early universe looks and how the Earth looks. There's no way you would confuse those two, right? This looks the way the structure of galaxies looks. There are long, sharp features, right? So know the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, right? There's features out here. There's features of the edges of the continents. There's these long, sharp regions. The only way you can get a long, sharp region is if there are nonlinear forces that are working together that take things of different wavelengths and different shapes and forces their faces all to match at a certain place. And so the surface of the Earth is made by nonlinear forces, just like the structure of galaxies and clusters of galaxies are nonlinear forces. In the case of galaxies, we know it's gravity. Here we know it has to do with the mechanics of the materials and with gravity and with other flows. And the other talk I was going to give you would talk about how that's going on and why Iceland is problematic if you live in Europe and you want to fly sometimes, right, because of what goes on. However, the forces that create space and time are obviously very linear. So it's an interesting kind of phenomenon. We have this situation where I didn't talk about it very early, where there's quantum mechanics, there are forces going on at the very beginning of the universe that are creating the space and time. So we have a very pretty picture where we start from almost nothing and we end up creating space and time. And then we take the energy that's doing that and turn it into the radiation and matter and so forth, then end up making the galaxies and so forth. And the byproducts of those all fit together. But the force that makes space and time doesn't make these long, sharp features. It doesn't make this complicated pattern. It's very random, uniform. The long scale structures and the short scale structures are not coupled together. It's a very linear kind of a process. So whatever force that is that you use, in general we use the thing called inflation, whatever model it is you use, the creation of space and time is extremely linear and straightforward talk. And that's very interesting. We'll hear about general relativity, which is a very elegant and very beautiful theory, but actually has a certain amount of nonlinearity in it. It's still the fabric of space and time itself turns out to be remarkably linear, but in the end, there's this complicated thing going on. So we learn something that you can learn yourself from just looking at that picture that is very simple and very spectacular about how the universe is created is actually a very simple process in some form. Okay, so enough philosophy. Let's back to pretty pictures. So I'm going to show you a series of movies, and then I'm going to show you the movies that I didn't embed in the thing. So we're going to start off in the solar system, and we're going to go out. The same time my colleagues and I were measuring the CMB and measuring galaxies, other people have been measuring stars. And so we've measured the location now of almost a billion stars. So this is a movie of flying out through the nearest like half billion stars in our galaxy. And it's very impressive, but then we have to start faking it because there's 400 billion stars in our galaxy. So a billion is, you know, less than a 400th, right? So if you want to see the galaxy, you're going to have to use Renoir and make an impression of the galaxy. So that's our Milky Way, and you saw we came from a spiral arm. That's the nearby galaxy, Andromeda and Fornax. We live in a small group. Ignore that. That's one of those wedges. Sorry. It's bad editing. I have a better movie I'll show you in a minute. So this is our local group. And you've got to go a long way before you get to any other nearby galaxies. So we live in a little village. And we have the biggest place in the village. There's some neighbors. And you get out to a certain distance, you can't see galaxies, regular galaxies anymore, only the really large red luminous galaxies and quasars, so they're shown in pink. So that's where we surveyed. Here's a different view of that going out a little further. And this is out to the furthest sphere that we're able to measure directly. And then it show you how much we've measured as of a couple of years ago, and then I'll show you a couple of movies that show this in a more, one that shows it in a higher quality version, and then one that's, so we have this fantastic picture of the universe, right, where some amazing thing happens at the beginning that causes the creation of space and time, at least the space and time we live in, and then later on everything falls out in a semi-automatic sort of way. So let me switch to show you the movies. All right, let me show you the other movie first. So this is the high production values version of this movie. We start from the highest point on the Earth. So the highest and the lowest point in the universe is 28 kilometers apart. Of the Earth is 28 kilometers apart. And the Earth's radius is 6,400 kilometers. So that's roughly apart in a couple hundred. But what you will see when you get further away, the features of the Earth shrink and are not so noticeable. And the Earth becomes very clearly a sphere, even though it's many hundred times less smooth than the universe as a whole. Now, this is all real data. You can do this on Google Earth. And these are the man-made satellites. This is the geosynchronous orbit, this white band. It's where the communication satellites are. Behind the orbit of the moon, so we're a whole light second away. Already the Earth looks very small. So the inner planets. So with the sun's true brightness, you're doing luminosity distance. That's a as far as mankind's signals have gone. So we're out on the spiral arm. Now, find your way home. This is where you want global GPS. It's hard to find our galaxy, much less our sun. Even when you find the sun, finding the earth isn't easy. A good option on Google Earth is to get rid of the cloudy days. Then you can see more. Okay, so I wanted to show you this more recent movie. Now, can I expand it? So this is a movie, unfortunately very dark, that shows you about two-thirds of the Boss galaxies. Unfortunately, it's so very dark, we meant to turn it. But what you can see is the, I can try and start it back further. On my screen, you can see, you see a large cluster, and you see how others link to other large clusters. But these, this is the section where many wedges are together, so you don't have the sort of 2D effect, you have the 3D effect. You see there are places where there are voids. You can see small clusters of galaxies, large clusters of galaxies, big complicated structures that exist out there. Sorry, it looks much better on my screen. But you have to have good, whoops. No, it's bad on that screen now. But But if you look around, you will see it's a very rich, complicated structure that exists out there. Unfortunately, it's hard to see. Or can you see it better than I can? Yeah, all right, well, maybe later on or some other way we'll do it. But you'll see all these structures out here, and you see how there's clusters and clusters of clusters, and some are small and some are large and so forth. All right, well, let me stop that and see if there are questions before I go into the last. How much time do I have? 15 minutes. All right, so I have a last little talk that Ivan promised you I would do. Okay, so are there any questions or comments, or should I launch on into the first light part? If there are questions, otherwise I'll just do this. Yeah, I asked for questions. Yes. Yes. Right.
They look very random. Why would you say they're artifacts?
They are what?
They look very random.
They are very, very random, yes. There are no linked patterns. As far as we can tell, there is, on every scale, it's random compared to every other scale. There's no coupling between things with a long wavelength and a short wavelength are not coupled. They're just completely random, one superimposed on the other. So they're very random compared to looking at the surface of the Earth or looking at the structure of clusters of galaxies. They're very obviously, you know, linked together, that there is a large structure with a lot of clusters of galaxies, and there are many things that are hooked together.
For me, a pattern means structure.
Right. So it's a pattern, but it's a random I mean, it's not a repeating pattern. It's a random slash pattern, right? And it's not just completely, you know, regular or anything. It's just completely random. Yes? Sorry.
So when you think about the end of the universe, you're quite sure that what you see there is the end of it. How are you sure that there are no more waves in the matter that we go?
Okay. So there's several ends of the
universe.
There's the ends of the universe. So you're asking about the end of the universe in space. The edge of the universe. Yeah. Right, and so the answer is, I tried to be careful to say that's what we could see. That's the observable universe. And we can only see as far as light has traveled. So if the universe is almost 14 billion years old, we cannot get light from further than 14 billion light years. If there was something that was 15 billion light years away, that light would not have reached us yet. So for our observable universe, right? So in the simple model, the way I usually made the pictures and so forth, you assume the universe is infinite or very, very much bigger. So our universe is flat and very simple, easy to draw and so forth. And however, you can make models of the universe in which the universe is finite in two different ways. You can make the universe be closed, the geometry of space be like a big sphere and close upon it. It's like, where's the edge of the Earth? There's no edge of the Earth. You don't fall off the Earth, but you sail around, you get back to where. You can make the universe geometry very much like a globe, right? Only in one extra dimension. You can make it infinite in different ways, or you can make it like a video game where you go off this edge of the screen, you come back on that edge of the screen. And those are cellular, or, you know, are closed. They're topologically closed universes. And so I had a student who got her PhD thesis with me looking to see that, and we were able to show for simple kind of cellular universes that the size is at least as big as 3/4 of the size of the universe. And there have been many more studies since then, because there are more complicated ways to connect the edges and do kinds of things. And so far, all the evidence is that the universe is very big, but there's no evidence that it's that it's infinite, because it could be made with mirrors, it could be made with complicated kinds of devices. And there's a difference between the geometry, Ed will probably talk some about geometry, and the topology, right? Because you can always imagine a universe that's like a donut that, you know, doesn't have the ends, but it has what. And but as far as we can tell, the topology and the geometry lead to a universe that's very large compared to what we see, or on the scale of what we see, or bigger.
30.7 billion years.
Yeah, so that means there is a beginning of time as far as our part of space-time is concerned. Now, there are arguments about what might have existed before our part of the universe existed, and there are versions in which there's nothing, literally nothing, and there are versions for which this just butted off from a more complex thing where time doesn't have exactly the same kind of meaning, because it's all like a plate of spaghetti, it's all mixed up and so forth. So there's many different versions of how the universe could have been before it formed what we did. But we went through this very complicated phase in which everything that we see in the universe today was compressed into a region that was very small and very hot and very dense and a very different form. And from that, our space and time and the variations in our space and time and the material in our space and time came out. And it's like a birth. It's like, you know, it's like being born at that point. And so we can, you know, we can kind of see that. And so we know that from studying the relic radiation from the Big Bang, the cosmic microwave background, which is the next little part I was going to talk about. But we can see. Are there more questions? So both of those were good questions. Oh, go ahead.
I'm not sure if it's related, but when you were talking about the spheres that you observed, you said that the diameter of the solar system is about 1 light year.
Well, the diameter, the solar system has the planets, you know, out to Pluto or the minor or the subplanets or whatever they're called these days. And then there's the Oort cloud. And then the definition is, how far out do you claim is our territory, right?
Throughout the years, the Voyager
has been set to 3 years. Right. Well, every year it reaches the edge. Right. So it depends on your definition of what the solar system is. Is it the planetary system? Is it the Oort cloud? Or is it our sphere of influence, right? Where is it until we capture everything, or the next star starts capturing anything? And that's, since the nearest star is a little over 4 light years away, then, you know, extending out about a light year is sort of reasonable definition. But it's a light month if you want to count stuff that we know is orbiting and is well behaved. And there have been searches for a binary companion. It's quite possible that there was another star orbiting our sun and our solar system at quite a great distance, and occasionally it perturbs the Oort cloud and so on. There have been searches for that. If it was a very dim star, a star that really didn't have nuclear ignition, but it's kind of like a giant Jupiter, it could be very dim and it would be very hard to detect. And so we don't know for sure, right? That's why I'm saying it's roughly that sort of scale. Any further out, then chance encounters of other stars and everything will perturb things away from our solar system. Yes? No, you're not. It's just, since my voice was wearing down. Now is it better? Okay, thank you. I realize I have to protect my voice and not yell, because I still have to give another talk. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the cosmic microwave background. In the background, I will explain what that means, even though there are some people here who have never seen a TV set. Okay, so the cosmic microwave background, the relic radiation from the Big Bang, so unfortunately part of this is in French, we'll see, is something that comes from a century ago, and it's the thing that was the generation of the idea of quantum mechanics. So Max Planck was working on the problem of how to explain what the intensity of a body, which was a black body in those days, were whole radiation. So they make a big cavity that was as absorbing as they could and heat it up to a certain temperature and see the radiation came out. And that was considered to be a black body because it absorbed any light that came in, and therefore by thermodynamics, it should have a certain relationship going out. And so he postulated that you could have, you could define that radiation curve, the spectrum, that little, the peak curve that goes up and comes back down, that you could find that if you assume light was made of quanta, little quantum units, and he made a thing called Planck's constant, and in the end, that was shown to be true, and he got the Nobel Prize for it. So it was one of the early Nobel Prizes, and so that was one of the experiences for me getting the Nobel Prize. That was sort of going through the whole ceremony. There was a whole long week of ceremonies, and all these kind of amazing things happen, and you get all these wonderful experience, and then at the end, when you're done, they have you come to the Nobel Foundation to say, you know, do you really mean to give your money to charity? And we can't, we don't want to do that because we're responsible. We have to show we gave it to you. And I said, if you give it to me, I have to pay taxes. And so there was this big thing. At the end, they have this book they bring out, and they take your picture, and they put your picture in it, and they have you write some stuff and sign your name. And you open this book, and there's Rentgen, and there's Planck, and there's Einstein. And you think, wait a minute. How am I going to write my name well enough to fit in this book? But anyway, so he was one of the early, he was on the early pages, I remember. I've forgotten the exact date. But so it's the, it's a major turning point. But it's relevant that I bring this up because if this radiation came from the early part of the universe, it makes our understanding and our knowledge of the universe much more straightforward, because it means the early universe was in complete thermodynamic equilibrium, just like radiation ricocheting around in a big cavity has many interactions, and the cavity is all the same temperature, you get to the right stuff. If we show that's the case, that's what's going on. And so the CMB turns out to be black body radiation. That's one of the two reasons that John Mather and I shared the Nobel Prize, was proving that it had the right spectrum and then finding these variations. So here are examples of black body with Planck's picture still. The top one is the sun, which is 6,000 Kelvin. So I exaggerated by a factor of two because the CMB, when it decouples, is about 3,000. And room, boiling water, a room at 20 degrees C, 0 degrees C, they're not very far apart. This is peaks in the infrared. That's why infrared cameras show people and rooms and so forth very well. And then here is liquid helium at 4 Kelvin and the cosmic microwave background radiation at 2.7 Kelvin. And I'll show you the data for this a little while longer. These all have the same shape. Since this is a log plot, I'm sorry, for some reason the scales, this gets cuts off. But if you just slide this along, you will find they have exactly the same shape. They just scale one relative to the other. There's only one freedom, which is the normalization, and that makes it slide left or right, and there's only one degree of freedom to do that. And so in 1965, almost 50 years ago, Penzias and Wilson, Arnold Penzias and Robert Wilson, measured an excess antenna temperature at 4 megahertz, and they were trying to do an experiment, which you all know succeeded, which was to find out, they were hired by Bell Labs, basically fresh out of graduate school, to do an experiment to see if it was possible to send communication signals to satellites and back to the Earth. Now we know that's a success because I showed you the geosynchronous belt, which every spot has taken, but at the time it was not known, and so Bell Labs had built a horn antenna by a person named Hogg, H-O-G-G, and they had done communications to the Telstar satellite, which had been launched the year before, and show that they could send a signal to it and get back to the ground, and they needed to know what the background temperature was to know what the signal noise, to know if it would be cost effective to actually use communications through satellites. And the reason that's relevant is in those days, it was expensive to put satellites in orbit. Any reasonable amount of weight was very expensive. But also, there just wasn't that much power and radio transmitters and available signal to go. So the signal to noise, that is, you want a signal to noise that's roughly 5 or higher in order to have reliable communications that you can do, they needed to know what the background noise was. And so they hired two radio astronomers, right? Penzias, who was a postdoc, and Wilson, who was just finishing his PhD, whose very first paper was the discovery of the cosmic microwave background. Good start, you know. And told them to go out and measure the temperature of the universe. And they were radio astronomers, and they thought, what we really want to do is go out and measure the hydrogen in the galaxy. We know that would be an interesting thing to map. So, but that's at a wavelength of 21 centimeter. But the antenna that existed for communicating with Telstar worked at 4 gigahertz, 480 megahertz. And so their bosses were pressuring to get the answer right away because they wanted to get back in the queue for doing more stuff. And so they went out and made a very careful measurement, and they discovered, surprisingly, there was this excess antenna temperature beyond what came from the galaxy, beyond anything else, which, as far as they could tell, was, you know, isotropic, unpolarized, and free from seasonal variation. That is, it was, no matter where they looked, it was always the same. Now, it turns out other people had seen there was extra signal no matter where they looked. They figured it was something wrong with their equipment. But these guys were very careful. But if I had more time for a talk, or if you guys ask me later, I'll show you. I have some pictures of their original equipment. They had wonderful equipment because they weren't working in a university. They were working in a company that had money and had big decisions to make. And so they had a liquid helium load, and they had a very good radio receiver and everything. They were able to make a very good measurement, and we're convinced that what they found was true. So this gives you an example. This is the antenna behind them. This is the house where they stand, where the receivers were. This is big enough for a person, so you can see the scale of this. I think it's roughly 10 meters on the side kind of thing. But this is a big, straightforward antenna. There had been a Princeton group who were kind of looking to see if there was any relic radiation left over. One of the models they had was a bouncing universe where it got recycled and the heat should be building up, and they were wanting to see what the limit was on heat. And Vicky, who had worked during World War II on building radar and so forth, had actually made a measurement out of the radiation lab at MIT and showed this guy a temperature of less than 20 and forgot about it, and it wasn't until later and they dug it up. And so they were slowly at Princeton trying to build this. In the meantime, these guys made the measurement. This is a picture of them some 13, 14 years later when they got the Nobel Prize. They were much younger then, and Wilson still had hair at the beginning. He was getting bald by the time he got the prize. And the interesting thing is they made the measurements very quickly. They got recognized 14 years later, and then 20 years later, this got made into a national landmark, right? So that's the kind of time scale. It takes the Park Service longer than it takes the Nobel Committee to make the decision, right? So they accident isn't exactly the right word, because many people found it by accident, but they didn't prove it. They found it by accident, and they followed through enough. They saw a surprise, and this is true when you talk to other Nobel Prize winners. It's quite often the case they saw something unusual, and instead of ditching it, they looked to see if they understood what was causing it, and they found out it was something really interesting. Right? So that was, and sometimes it wasn't, but sometimes, occasionally it was, and that made a big difference. Right? And then this is in French, so we'll skip that. So here's an example of people who discovered it before. So Adams and McKellar had seen excitation in CN molecules in the direction of the stars Ophiuchus. You can see the absorption lines. The line ratios between the different lines showed that there was a temperature of about 2.3 Kelvin. Within a few days of the time Penzias and Wilson made their publication, a number of people remembered these measurements and brought it up and were talking about them at conferences and so on. So later on. And nobody had thought about the Big Bang then. So they just thought, well, 2.3 Kelvin, that's interesting. There's some source that's causing this, we don't know. Could be extra heat in the cloud, could be anything like that. But the issue was, how is the whole universe so uniform when we're moving around, our galaxy's moving around, and our local group is moving around? And so we'll see, and we see, so we've had this idea of the universe where we have looking at the sphere around us and looking back in time. We've looked with COBE, then with WMAP, and then with Planck. And what we see back to a time when the universe was roughly 300,000ths of the time it is today. So in terms of your existence, it's about the equivalent of 6 to 12 hours after your conception. Right? It's the time when you're deciding to be two cells instead of one cell. Right? So it's early, very early in the phase of the universe. Okay, so here's a sketch we made and had to alter. This is one we made about 14 years ago. So we made this chart of what the temperatures were and what accelerators matched, what was going on in the universe, to finally get thinking, man. And then the accelerating universe came, so we had to make the line come out a little further. So it was lined up along this way. But this is talking about all the exciting things that happened in the early universe, where you're having the fundamental particles, and then you're making protons and neutrons, and then eventually you make the elements, and then you make the atoms, and then so forth, all the kind of things that go on. Okay, so on to the story about Kobe. So this shows you the, whoops, again. So on my screen, so I'm not sliding John. On my screen, my picture, his picture, my picture show up. But on this one, it's for some reason, the screen sharing doesn't work. But if you look at the spectrum that was measured by Kobe, this is the measurement. And these boxes just show you where the data points were. And this is the black body radiation. So John and I shared the prize. He was the PI for the instrument that measured the spectrum very precisely. And he had a lot of the critical ideas for designing that instrument. I was responsible. I was a PI for the instrument that made the mapping. But it was a shared kind of activity for the whole thing. So sorry for the cutoff. Okay, so what this is showing is that in terms of all the radiations that exist in the universe, the cosmic microwave background dominates. So this is a plot which is on a log scale, so there's an extra factor here. It shows you just by area what fraction of the energy in the universe falls on all the different bands. So this is the radio band. This is the cosmic microwave band, which is about over 90% of all the radiation. The cosmic infrared background, which is all the signal from the first stars and galaxies forming and the elements being burned in the stars and so forth. And the optical, the ultraviolet, the X-ray background, the gamma ray background. The gamma ray background looks big, but you look, this is the log scale, the amplitude is much smaller. So the universe is dominated by the cosmic microwave background. Now, that isn't necessarily what you notice on the Earth. So here's the explanation. So some of you may remember the really old days when we had CRT televisions before flat screens and so forth. And we had broadcast before cable and internet. And if you looked on your TV and you looked between channels or you switched to where the channel was turned off at night, you would see this snow on your screen. And you could actually, some of that snow were photons coming from the cosmic microwave background. And for a typical TV, the noise, well, most of the noise was noise from the receiver itself. But for a typical receiver in those days, about 1% of the signal was from the cosmic microwave background, about 1% was from the galaxy down those wavelength bands. Right? Now with satellite TVs, there's a few people still have satellite TVs. If you switch off, you can actually get a much higher percentage that's cosmic microwave. But most people never do that because the satellites are on all the time and it's all going along in the same way. So that was what that background was at the beginning. Okay, so before the CMB was measured more precisely, we had two explanations that people were doing. One was the Big Bang and one was the steady state theory. One where the universe was expanding and matter was being created, and the other one where everything was there from the beginning and it was just cooling and diluting. And this is the theory that survives. And the universe in the present day has a lot of complicated structure. It has all those galaxies and these complicated structures. But as I showed you at the beginning, the universe is extremely uniform. So here are some maps that I made in the good old days. So this is the actual data. This is what the sky would look like if you had microwave eyes and went outside to look. This actually has all the data in it. It has the cosmic microwave background, which dominates the galaxy, which is this line coming across here when you blow the scale up by a factor of 100,000. There is a galaxy in here, all that's in here. But if you had microwave sky, all we just see is this uniform diffuse glow. But these incredibly small variations, the galaxy dominating across here, but these cool regions together, warm regions together, and so forth. Or what you see when you subtract away the galaxy and you subtract away the other features, you see this feature plus this idea of what the polarization might look like. And as I say, this is typically at a part of 100,000 level. So in our brief history of the universe, this is, whoops, that's Planck replacing the W map in what's going on. We have this period, which we haven't talked about very much, where there are quantum fluctuations and inflation. an early quantum mechanics and acceleration, a long deceleration where a structure is forming, and an acceleration later on, and this picture of what the early universe looked like when the universe was 300 thousandths of a year of a time smaller, and, or roughly half a day after conception for a 50-year-old, or 6 hours after for a person that's 25 years old. Okay, I think I should stop at this point and ask questions, even though I have a lot more material. Okay, more questions? No? Sorry, I didn't see you.
Could you talk about the polarization of the CMB, please?
Let me see if I have this stuff handy somewhere. I have these early plots. Where do I think I have polarization stuff in here, but this is about measuring the geometry. So this is fun. Let me do this just while we're going on. So we're on the Earth, and if space is flat, then it's Euclidean and you measure a triangle. But if you have a ruler and you look at it in a curved universe, right, if the universe is curved positively, light would diverge, and if it's curve negatively, light will converge, and so forth. So depending upon the angular size, you can try and see what it is. And somewhere I have a movie of this. But if you're looking and you see the map and it looks straightforward, right, then it's Euclidean space. If it's curving like that, then it's, you know, then it's a closed space. And if it's an open space like a saddle, then you get this kind of shape. And this is how we can kind of make these measurements and find the geometry of the universe. So then I skip over the acoustic oscillations. I thought I had some stuff about polarization in here. All right. That was lensing, but okay. So here's the issue. This part of the talk I wasn't going to give here. This is a little more technical. The issue is if you have uniform signal coming in, right, scattering off an electron, only the polarization is perpendicular to the plane of scattering comes through. So the radiation coming from here and the radiation coming from there, one gives this polarization, one gives that. So if you have unequal signal, you'll get a net polarization. That's what happens when the sun scatters off the surface or in this case, off the electrons. And so you end up getting a polarization which would normally have the pattern that looks either radially like that or that, if you just have energy density variation. But if you have gravity waves, the kind of thing that Ed will talk about, you'll end up with polarization patterns that look like that. And so the question is, which ones do we see? And the answer is, we definitely see these polarization patterns, and we must, and we can predict how big those signals should be, because we know there are density variations that eventually became the galaxies and so forth. And so we've seen the signal from that in terms of intensity, we've seen it in the polarization. The question is, do we have gravity waves? And the answer is we haven't seen that in the intensity, but it could be lower and we wouldn't see it hidden behind the other things. But we could see it in these, what we call the V modes, these complicated patterns. And there has been a lot of excitement in the last year because there's an experiment with fairly good data and fairly good discussion that claimed to have discovered it. Now it turns out that the dust from our own galaxy is partly polarized because of magnetic fields of our galaxy. And so there was a paper released yesterday by the Planck team saying as much as all of the signal they claim could have come from the galaxy, and we won't know until we do a cross-correlation between their observations and the galaxy, but there's enough from the dust that we'll see, and that should be coming out at the end of November. But we do see polarization. What we're looking for is the polarization that would come from the gravity waves, which would be an indication of the kind of the structure that was forming space and time, what energy scale it was and what was going on. If inflation happens at a very high energy scale, it will produce gravity waves and sufficient power to produce B modes that we would be able to see today. And then we can do all kinds of stuff. But one of the things we deal with is there's polarization and there's gravitational lensing by the galaxies in between. And some of the polarization from the density variations ends up being lensed to look like B-mode polarization, so you have to separate them. So it gets complicated because the gravity waves convert E-modes into some B-modes, so you have to look carefully at what that is compared to, there's a certain range in which if you see the gravity waves, the B modes, you're confident. There's another range where you have to separate the various ones. And so, so that's my gravity wave. And I wasn't going to give this part of the talk, but just because you asked the question. But this is a cutting edge, sort of more technical thing. But it's interesting because it has a way of telling us what is happening in that first fraction of a second. Yeah. The gravity waves come to us fairly much, you know, from not from the 300,000 years, three or 400,000 years, they come to us within a fraction of a second almost directly if we could observe them. Additional questions or comments? Are you ready for your concept map quiz? If we have enough time, we don't. Yes, all right. No, it's just about time for me to end. But are there any more questions or comments? And this part at the end here is a little more technical than I had expected to get. But. Okay. So you want to...